Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Would you please be upstanding for the Australian National Anthem?
Welcome to the 6th annual CrossFit Invitational. Australia and Melbourne are proud to host this international competition. This is the final stage of the CrossFit Games season, where the best individuals will join together to represent Europe, the United States, Canada, and our very own Pacific region. We're proud that the Pacific roster is full of Australian athletes, including Olympian and reigning fittest woman on earth, Tia Claire Toomey, and Cara Webb, silver medalist from the recent CrossFit Games. For the CrossFit community, the Invitational is a wonderful showpiece, highlighting the exceptional fitness, skill, determination, and sportsmanship that is all part of being a CrossFitter. These teams are ready to compete and give it their all to claim the title this year. I wish these games and all the competitors every success. Glory and triumph awaits. Let the games begin.
Cast your eyes to the screen, ladies and gentlemen. Please welcome out Team Canada. Coach of Team Canada, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet, 2014 CrossFit Games champion. Next, please welcome Carol Ann Reason-Tebow, coming off a top 15 CrossFit Games finish in both 2016 and 2017. Ladies and gentlemen, Alessandra Pacelli, second time representing Team Canada and knocking down the door of the top 10 at the CrossFit Games in 2017. Next, please welcome Patrick Vellner, coming off back-to-back podium finishes at the CrossFit Games, the third fittest man. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome out Brent Fukowski. Seven top four finishes in Madison this year, including two event wins. He is the second fittest man on earth. Ladies and gentlemen, cast your eyes back up to the screen as we introduce Team USA. Ladies and gentlemen, the coach of Team USA, Adam Neifer. A
veteran of CrossFit team competition.
Next, please welcome Kerry Pierce, returning to Team USA with top 10 finishes in both 2016 and 2017 CrossFit Games.
Ladies and gentlemen, Tennille Reed-Berline, sixth finisher at the CrossFit Games in 2017.
Next, please welcome Scott Panchek. Since 2012 at the Games, he has placed fourth, fifth, sixth, and sixth.
And ladies and gentlemen, Noah Olsen. First time representing the USA, coming off a fourth place at the 2017 CrossFit Games. Back up to the screens, ladies and gentlemen, we reintroduce your defending champs, Europe team. Of Team Europe, Samantha Briggs, 2013 CrossFit Games champion.
Next, please welcome Jason Smith. In his rookie season, this South African athlete took 10th place at the CrossFit Games.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome out Jorgen Carl Goodmanson, third place finisher at the CrossFit Games in 2015. He returns for his fourth invitational appearance.
Next, we welcome Sarah Sigmundsdottir. This woman has finished fourth or better in each of her three appearances at the CrossFit Games. She has represented Europe in the invitational since 2015.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome out Annie Forrestotter, two-time CrossFit Games champion and current third fittest woman on earth. And last but not least, up at the screens, ladies and gentlemen, we introduce Team Pacific.
Athletes, on me. You guys know event one, two, three.
3, you do not know 4 or 5. Event 1 is a medium duration CrossFit team test. Event 2 is an agility and handstand walking test. Event 3 is another CrossFit burner. Event 4 will be a test of strength. Event 4 will be a partner clean. Not partner clean like you're both cleaning at the same time, but a partner clean in the sense of you will both be cleaning a large load. It'll be alternating. One individual will go, and then the next individual will go. Back and forth for as many reps as possible in 2 minutes. The men will go first. In the first minute, you have to alternate. So one athlete goes, the other athlete goes. If one gets stuck, you're waiting. After the first minute is done, you have another minute to continue on, and anyone can do the reps. So the men go first, 2 minutes, we have a transition, and then the women go. Event 4 will not use a barbell. Event 4 will use those big fucking tires. On the go call, one athlete will flip, and then the other athlete will have to flip. Beep. So in this case here, what would happen? He would get stuck over there. Pretend like you're trying. And he can't get it. So for 1 full minute, they're stuck in this situation. At the 1 minute mark, they still have an additional minute of work where now he could do as many flips as he can do in that minute. Does that make sense? This is not for distance, this is for total reps. But you'll go from that red line, and if you make it over there, cross that red line, you'll just turn around and you'll come back. Again, it's not for distance, it's for reps. What's gonna happen now is you guys have an opportunity to play with these, to warm up on the ropes, warm up with the bar muscle ups, and do your thing out here for a few minutes before you head back, okay? So if you wanna flip a tire, come over here, get in line, and start practicing.
The Anzac spirit. It is part of every Aussie. It is who we are as a country. Tenacity. Perseverance. Being there for your mates, no matter what. It is a set of values that drove two of our own to stand atop of the podium at the CrossFit Games. Today, it bonds four Aussies together in a quest for international supremacy. They face fierce competition, the defending champs, a hungry team from North America, and a former powerhouse looking to recapture past glory. But our team has an advantage. They are home. A nation is behind them. Their mates are next to them. And they are all there for each other, no matter what. The Anzac spirit. The 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational starts now.
We are live from the land down under. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational from the Margaret Court Arena in Melbourne, Australia. I am Sean Woodland alongside the mayor of Australian CrossFit, Jeremy Austin. We have had six invitationals now. Two have been in North America. Three have been in Europe. We have finally made it down here to Australia. What does it mean to this community to have this event here?
Mate, I'm pumped. It's not for me personally, but for this entire Pacific community. We've got 16 of the best athletes on the planet down under, which is just amazing. We've both been in the sport for about 10 years. The growth's been awesome, not just here in Australia, but also New Zealand as well. Having the Invitational in Melbourne, just incredible.
For the first time, the Pacific team will be the home team, and this may be their best chance to win it all. They have all four athletes returning from last year. They have this home crowd behind them, and they have the two fittest women on earth on their roster.
They sure do. And Kara Webb, she's got so much experience. She's got five Invitational appearances, six consecutive Games appearances. This girl will enjoy this competition today. And going on to the other team member, which is Tia Claire Toomey. What a 14 months she's had. She comes in as the second fittest woman on the planet. Then she goes to the Olympics. And then she tops it off with a first place. She's the fittest woman on the earth. Can she just eat this up today?
Those two women trying to lead the Pacific team to their very first win here at the Invitational. They've never finished higher than third, and if they are going to do that, they will have to dethrone the defending champions. That is the Europe team. They have two of their four athletes back from their championship year last year. That is Sarah Sigmund's daughter and Bjorgen Carl Gubenson. Jason Smith and Annie Thora's daughter are the two new athletes this year. They are a very balanced team, but they did not get a full week of practice in.
They did not. Sarah getting very sick earlier in the week from the flight over. She missed a couple of team trainings when they were doing the synchronized stuff. We were there to watch that. Sam jumped in just in case she was needed. I don't know if that's going to be crucial or not, but we'll have to wait and see.
Sam Briggs, for the third straight time, is the coach of the Europe team, and she spoke earlier with our own Caleb Anfield.
Sam, many of us know that Sarah's not been feeling very well leading up into this event. How has that affected your team training?
It's been fine. I filled in for her on the first day just to do the team workouts, but then she was back training with us on the second day, and then we all trained yesterday morning just to get an extra session in as a team because she missed out, and like night and day better from the day before, so she's all ready to rock and roll.
So you've had a couple of days together now. From those training sessions, what do you believe is the focus for Team Europe this weekend?
We were just trying to focus on the worms. They're all individual athletes, so that's something new to them that they're not used to doing, like lifting, the Barmer slopes, everything, like handstand walking. That's something that they incorporate in their training anyway. So the worms, something new to them that we tried to focus on as soon as we were given one to practice with.
Speaking of new movements, I'm guessing the tyre's probably new for this dynamic as well. What are your thoughts on that event?
I'm looking forward to it, especially like the girls, the strong girls. I want to see them like ripping through those tyre flips.
Good luck today.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Thank you, Kayla. Thank you, Sam Briggs, trying to lead the Europe team for their second straight Invitational Championship. The first of five events, they will work in mixed pairs until the final movement. We begin with 40 rope climbs, and then they end with that implement. Rory McKernan is on the floor with more on the infamous worm.
Thank you, Sean. The ropes will be the gatekeeper, but a win in this event will come from teamwork, and nothing tests teamwork better than the worm. The athletes will have to work together, or they will be punished together on this implement. Now, they got to practice for about an hour and a half with this implement, but never on this competition floor. So I want you guys to pay close attention. If a team is getting no reps and you're confused why, look to the anchor. When they were allowed to practice with the implement earlier on the competition floor, you would see the anchor slipping their heels over the gray line. Every time that they advance down the competition floor, the athlete in the back needs to be in front of the gray line or the rep doesn't count.
Thanks, Ro. The rope, this is going to come down to who can get up and down with the less fatigue. 40 rope climbs is no joke.
And we're using that short rope, and that presents a whole different problem sometimes because it's a lot harder to wrap your feet around it once you get yourself anchored on that thing. James Newberry, the athlete and coach for the Pacific team, Jason Smith, and the Europe team ready for event one of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Each pair has to complete 20 rope climbs. There is no minimum work requirement, and there is no requirement as to how you need to break the work up. As long as each pair gets 20 rope climbs, they will be able to advance. James Newberry for the Pacific team, he is also the coach, working his way up. Keep your eye on top of the screen. The team that is in the lead will have its name highlighted in blue. In the white box will be the number of reps they have completed. The other teams, the number in the white box, will indicate how many reps back they are of the leader. There are 78 total repetitions in this event.
Sean, I've noticed already, especially the U.S. team, they're doing most of them legless at the moment to get that lead, and they're just getting up and down so much faster. You can see from Noah Olsen getting those knees as high as he can, using those hips as much as possible to propel himself up the rope.
Tenille Reed-Burline is on the right. Scott Panchik is now on the left as the United States is through 18 of their 40 rope climbs. Canada sits in second. The Pacific team and the Europe team are now fighting for third place. The winner of this event will get 6 points. Second place receives 4. Third place will receive 2. And then fourth place gets 0 points. So it's very important to finish inside the top 3 if you want to keep yourself in contention for the overall win here at the Invitational. There are 5 total events. 4 of them are known. 1, however, is not. Tia Toomey tagging off to James Newberry as the Pacific team currently sits in third place in this event.
Brent Fikowski using that extra height that he has got. Sean, you mentioned it earlier that he is the tallest person on the field this weekend. And he's just doing, getting his feet grabbing onto the rope and just having a bit of a stumble there. But every other rope climb, he's been able to stretch that entire body out and get a touch at the top.
The United States currently has a lead there through 32 of their 40 rope climbs, and Rory McKernan is with them.
Sean, that's perfectly according to the plan. I just spoke to Adam Knifer, the coach from USA. He said he broke this into 3 parts: fast, smooth, together. He wants the athletes to get to the machines first for Team USA. Then they can smooth it out before they get to the worm. They did a lot of work with the worm. Remember, Adam Knifer has been in the CrossFit Games on a team for 9 straight years, so he knows what he's talking about once he gets to the teamwork portion of this workout.
Carrie Pierce is on the left. She just completed a rope climb. Tenille Reed-Burline has slowed down. She's on the right, but she gets credit for that rep. Scott Panchik and Carrie Pierce are done, and now Olsen and Tenille Reed are done, and the United States is first on to the rowing and the assault bikes. The men need to complete 35 calories on the rower. The women need to complete 20 calories, and then the men need to complete 30 calories on the bike. The women need to complete 20. They will switch when they are done. And every time an athlete finishes, they will get credit for 1 rep. Now Canada has joined the United States, Europe, and the Pacific team has reached the rowers and the bikes.
Sean, they've got to be really detailed in, and I'm sure Adam Knifer has done this with his team. There's no point rushing this portion of it because they can't move on as 2 onto that worm. They need all 4 there, so they need to make sure this synchronization is on point.
Tenille Reed-Burline on the assault bike for the U.S. team. They got to these implements first. They completed their 40 rope climbs the fastest. They did it in 2 minutes and 33 seconds. The men need to complete 35 calories on the rower and 30 calories on the bike, and the women need to complete 20 calories on each implement. So it's Panchik on the left, Olsen on the right, the 2 men on the rower for the United States. Carrie Pierce and Tennille Reed-Burline are on the bikes.
Jason Smith, he is a rookie coming in, but he is using those massive arms of his, and he has plowed through, just a little bit unsure to the rep scheme, but he is moving on to the row now, but he was the first athlete to get on after the air bike.
Canada has taken the lead as all four of their athletes finished their first set of calories. They have now switched, so the men are onto the rowers and the women are onto the salt bikes. The United States has made the transition, as has the Pacific team.
Right, they need to do some work. They're falling behind a little. The stage is not going to be any better set for them for this couple of hours down here in Melbourne. So they really need to move. They are now our current leaders, so they're doing just that.
Pacific team has now managed to catch the pack. The true indication will be, though, once all four athletes move on to the worm, where they will have to complete 30 worm cleans as a team. 5 minutes gone by here in the opening event of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Europe and Canada's judges both have their hands in the air. That does mean that their respective athletes are just about done with their work. And now hands up for the United States and the Pacific team. Carol Ann Reason-Tebow has finished her 20 calories, as has Sandra Pacelli. But Brent Fikowski and Patrick Fellner need to wrap up their 35 calorie row. Fellner's done. Fikowski with a few more cranks to go.
And as we mentioned earlier, it was not the rope, not the stuff in the middle that was going to stop these guys. It was the stuff either end. Who's got more in the tank now to bring this worm home? And Canada just ahead of Team Europe.
Canada, the bottom of your screen in the red. They need to move that to their shoulders from the ground. They'll do six reps on the right shoulder, walk it forward, and then do six reps on the left. There are 30 total worm cleans. 78 is the magic number that they need to hit. So Canada is in the lead right now. Europe sits in second. The Pacific and the United States are fighting for third. Remember, the winner gets 6 points. Second place gets four. Third place will get two, and fourth gets none. Very key to not put yourself in an early hole. The Europe team has taken the lead. They are through 55 of the 78 total reps, but here comes the Pacific team as they are just ahead of the United States for third place.
Pacific had a great start to last year's Invitational and just couldn't seal the deal. They need to have another good start here, and they are making up some time. These guys have been living together for about a week now. They've been eating together. They've been doing pretty much everything together, and I know Rob has got a worm at his gym, and no doubt they have been using it.
Team Europe starting to run into some trouble here as they have moved into fourth place. Canada and the Pacific are fighting for the lead. The Pacific team at the top of the screen, Canada as at the bottom. These are the two most experienced teams in the field. And now here comes the Europe team. So the United States had the early lead. They are now back in fourth place. Pacific team is now through 63, now 64 of their 78 total repetitions. This is the battle for first place. Pacific on the left, Canada is on the right. And the Pacific team has taken the lead with 12 reps to go. They are about one rep ahead of the Canada team.
Their movement just looks so smooth. They are not rushing anything at all. And I know James, he's a massive team player, but it seems as though Rob is calling it from the back. The communication really important, especially with this really vocal crowd.
Now the United States has moved up. They are solidly in fourth place. They have a lot of ground to make up here. The Pacific team on to their final six repetitions. And for the second straight year, they are looking to win the opening event of the Invitational. Five to go, now four to go for the Pacific team. Canada, two reps behind. One more now for the Pacific team. And the Pacific team takes event one.
And the crowd absolutely loving that one.
Great start for them. Now Canada trying to lock up 4 points. as they are in second place trying to hold off a charge from the Europe team. Canada is in. They will earn 4 points. And it's between the United States and Europe. As Europe is in, they'll earn 2. So the United States will start in an early hole. They will not get any points after this first event.
Well, first off the ropes, but they are our last team to come over the line and finish, and they have got some serious work to do over the next couple of events.
That is your winning team, the only team to go sub 9 minutes, 8 minutes, 43 seconds for the Pacific team, and they win the first of 5 events here at Margaret Court Arena in Melbourne, Australia, and this home crowd is loving that effort from their athletes. Brent Fikowski is worn out. Tia Toomey congratulating Camila Blanc-Bazinet. Tia Toomey, of course, the fittest woman on earth from the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. There are your official results as Canada edges out Europe by just 6 points per second. And it's the United States in fourth. Man, the United States started like they were shot out of a cannon.
Oh, big time. And going with the option of going legless right from the word go, and did it damage them later on. Canada doing very well in the middle section. And after what's happened over the last couple of years with Canada, that's a great start for them to be still in contention. The struggle with the women, no crucial no rep. You just can't have any in these competitions. And was it that work earlier on in the week with the communication with Sarah missing? But these guys, tell you, I'm pretty chuffed with that one.
The Pacific team winning event one for the second straight year, and they are with Rory McKernan.
All right, Rob, I know that you have a worm in your gym, and you guys got to practice with that, but it wasn't exactly this one. You had to cut off two segments of a six-person worm. How did this stack up with what you guys did in the gym to practice?
That felt a little bit easier in terms of communication, all the stuff that we went through the first couple of days. That's where you make mistakes. The modified worm felt pretty much the same as that, to be honest. So it was good for us to get together a few days early. It obviously paid off, didn't it?
All right, we're here in front of the hometown crowd. Cara, how does it feel competing in this environment? I know you do regionals all the time, but this is a lot different.
You know what? I have to catch myself because it's almost easy to not feel like the Invitational. I'm like, oh, it is a home in Melbourne, like just chilling with Aussies. But I have to stop every now and again, and Tia and I keep reminding each other, like, hey, this is pretty damn cool. Like, it hasn't happened here in front of our home crowd at home, so it's amazing.
All right, Tia, you won the first event at last year's Invitational. How do you keep this momentum going for the rest of the competition?
These guys, and then all of these guys. Yeah. Thank you so much. No, it's definitely knowing that the Invitational is in our home country is just unbelievable. We had to make sure we calmed ourselves down before we came out because it's so exciting. And thank you so much. And yeah, these guys are awesome. So it's easy.
All right. Pacific team off to a great start. Thanks, guys.
6 points for Rob Forte and company here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational as the Pacific team takes the early lead. One event is down, 4 to go. Up next, it's the handstand walk course. Event 2 coming up next here in Melbourne. Thank you.
I was 92. And the lady next door but one, she said to me, I know you're active, George, she said, but why don't you come to CrossFit?
I can remember when he first came, it was already open and he was just standing over there talking. And I didn't know he was going to come. And he came in and he said, oh, my neighbour said I should come up and join.
I went over to CrossFit and I saw Sophie.
And he said, oh, I'm 92. And I was like, oh, right, OK. But he was up and about and chatting and talking to people, and he showed me he could touch his toes. He said he'd driven here. So clearly he wasn't an average 92-year-old.
I think diabetes kind of loomed large because it felt like I was already defeated when I started. But I realize now diabetes is a real condition, but the obstacle that I thought I was facing that I couldn't beat, that doesn't exist. What I can do and what is in my control is just to make one good decision at a time. There's a lot of value in just moving your body and putting the right fuel in it.
If I could go back in time and warn myself about what would happen when I lift that barbell, would I change anything?
And with this lift, Kevin will win the event.
I think mentally I knew that if I didn't have goals, I was gonna have a really rough time recovering from this.
He was going back to CrossFit.
I immediately knew after my accident that I needed to get back to coaching and training.
Guys, welcome to your level one seminar.
Why do you want to be on CrossFit staff?
I've been doing CrossFit for 7 years. It's saved my life. It's changed my life.
The red shirts, they are the best trainers in the world.
No adaptive athlete has made the team. None has even attempted the internship process.
I definitely don't think that right now he's ready.
The best way to look like a fool is to tell Kevin he can't do something.
The standard phone when I was a kid was like a Nokia that had Snake, you know what I mean? And now the standard phone, everyone's like an iPhone, which is like pretty much a computer monitor on their hands, which they can like Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, shop, Amazon Prime, whatever it is. There's apps on apps on apps. I feel kids are definitely isolated. They're in their phone instead of in the present moment with their friends. They'll be in a group, a social setting, but no one is actually socializing. I think it definitely distorts the social interactions. You know, right now, with all the budget cuts and all that, kids aren't even generally active at schools. So one of the ways with our CrossFit program, there was really no CrossFit teens, CrossFit kids programs out there. And, you know, for me, coming from my past, from the way I was affected with, you know, being a young kid, being exposed to fitness, and the benefits that I saw with it, I definitely wanted to just come here and bring some of the Santa Cruz. We always do check-ins in the beginning, you know, how's everyone's weekend, what's new, what movies have people seen? What's popular in culture right now? What cartoons are really cool? What's a cool reference to give them? You know, I'm a big Harry Potter guy. I'll be honest with you, I'm put on the table. I think the way I connect with these kids and the way that I coach these kids compared different to the adults is I have no problem putting myself out there and just being a kid with them. But it's such a uniform way that we do our movements, Monday, Wednesday, Fridays. Even though the lifts will be different, it's always the same. I would say like 6 lifts in rotation. You know, basic movements, squats, presses, and then I'm a big Olympic lifter, so we really expose our kids to the Olympic lifts. When I see all ages performing in Olympic movements and looking good, looking sound, it makes me feel really good. And to see these kids create this like strong base, not only the technique is there, but to create this kind of base where whatever they want to do as they grow, they want to play soccer, they want to go run track, it just gives them this strong foundation where now they're free to go with whatever they want to choose. I feel really good with the consistency of the kids. I feel really good with the steady growth. The retention is probably my favorite because, you know, the longer a kid stays, the longer I actually get to know them. I get to connect with them. Always at the end, I'm so stoked that I do it. My name is Daniel J, and I'm a CrossFit Kids coach.
DJ told me practice, so before I rap this, I was doing muscle ups, handstands, gymnastics, box jumping with rabbits, yoga stretches with bad chicks, meditation and backflips. I could rap this backwards. I don't think y'all getting it. My name Eric Charles. I done lost my marbles, running hill sprints with these barbells. Man, I'm flexing on you bros. I lost respect for all you hoes. Am I spending big? Hell no. Never drop no checks on none of y'all. Now this getting comical. I'ma go full throttle though. Out this world and up in smoke. I'm so astronomical. A whole nother animal. Boy, so damn phenomenal. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Take my pick and buy my nose.
The Pacific team giving this crowd something to cheer about early as they take event one. They have a two-point lead over Canada. It's Europe in third. And the United States currently sits in fourth. And for the first time in invitational history, the U.S. comes in as a bit of an underdog. And the reason why, they only have one athlete who has made an invitational appearance before. That's Carey Pierce. However, their coach, Adam Neifer, could be a bit of an X factor here.
Absolutely. He's had so much experience at the games, 9 times consecutive in teams, so he knows what he's doing in that team concept. So can he actually get this team up from fourth place in that first event and get them up that leaderboard?
Caleb Anfield is standing by with the coach of the USA team.
Thanks, Sean. First things first, Adam, how did you find that first event?
It was fast. All the teams were neck and neck right up to the finish line, so it was cool.
What have you told the team to focus on now moving forward that one event's in the bag?
Just like any competition, the highs are never that high, the lows are never that low, so it didn't go perfectly for us, but we're going to put it in the past and focus on handstand walking as fast as we can.
Now, you're no stranger to coaching. How have you found coaching the Invitationals team compared to the Games and Regionals?
Absolute honor and pleasure. It's been amazing. These guys are amazing to work with, great work ethic, and just really good people, so it's been fun, and I've learned a lot along the way, too.
Awesome. Well, congratulations, Adam, and good luck for the rest of the day.
Thank you.
The United States with some work to do as they head into event number two. Canada, meanwhile, sits in second place after the first event, and if it weren't for the Pacific team, they would be the most experienced team in the field. 3 of their 4 members are back from last year. Sandra Pacelli is the newest team member, and if they're going to win this thing, they're going to have to rely on the strength of their men.
Absolutely. This consistency of these two guys is unbelievable. Patrick Vellner, he's gone third and third in the last 2 years. That means something. He's doing something right, and I think he's going to work really well with Fikowski over the next couple of hours. And Fikowski, he's doing the same thing. He's gone from fourth to second, so I don't know what they're doing up there, but the guys are doing it right.
For the second straight year, Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet is the head coach of the Canada team, and she is with Caleb Anfield.
Camille, you just told me that you're carrying around a bag of food for the athletes. I saw you doing their hair before. How are you finding coaching Team Canada?
I think it's a good practice to maybe like what it is to be like a mom with like people under really high pressure and stress.
Athletes are kind of like babies, aren't they?
Yeah.
So what's the plan now moving forward? One event down.
I just need to make sure that my team stay focused on what's coming. So this event is over. They're not thinking about it. They're already like getting all warmed up for the handstand walk. So as long as they're just staying in a right mindset, super focused, I think they're going to do well.
And if I can focus on one thing, what would it be?
Oh, having fun and making their country proud. I think they all have it a lot in their heart to be like very honored to be here and represent Canada. So as long as they hang on to that, they'll be good.
Absolutely. And it is such a super fun event, so I'm sure they will have a lot of fun. Thank you and good luck.
Thank you.
Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet would love to be doing this next event. It's a handstand walk course. All four athletes will go through it separately, and then the team with the fastest total time will win. And this is a new challenge, unlike anything we've ever seen.
Well, we've seen distance, we've seen for time, but we haven't seen obstacles. We saw them on the floor yesterday having a bit of a practice. I'm not sure if they're going to go as fast as they can, but it's going to come down to the strategy on the floor.
Roy McKernan is on the competition floor with more on the handstand walk course.
Well, we've seen handstand walks in CrossFit Games competition since 2011, but never a twist on the old favorite quite like this. I have with me Adrian Bosman. He's not just the head judge of the CrossFit Games, but also one of the men responsible for this test. Adrian, what did you guys come up with this?
Well, we know that all these athletes are great on their hands, so we wanted to up the ante a little bit, and we've seen that a lot of athletes train some of these tricky skills, so we want to see what happens when we put them to the test.
All right, you got your hands on this thing. You saw them practice yesterday. What's going to be the most difficult part of the course?
The most difficult part of the course is the end stage here, because the first time you do it, you're fresh. It feels like it's no big deal. When you see it the second time, the accumulated fatigue really makes a big difference.
And they got one event underneath them, so Sean, Jeremy, it's all going to come down to the final obstacle.
Thank you, Ro. The plate pyramid is the final obstacle. It doesn't look like much, but we watched some of the athletes practice this thing, and it was not easy for them.
It wasn't. We saw some athletes actually get their hand in that gap between the plates, also hands going off to the side of the plates. So coming up to that last obstacle, I'm sure they're going to be kicking down and then just waiting and trying to recover enough to make sure they get through that unscathed.
The men will go first, followed by the women, then the men again, and then the women will run the anchor leg. Noah Olsen will be up first for the United States.
Noah Olsen, the last couple of years, he's done so well with the handstand walking events. First at regionals in 2014, getting 315 feet. He's no stranger to walking on his hands. So can he back it up now with the obstacle course and see get through that under that two-minute time cap?
James Newbery will be up first for the Pacific team. He is athlete and coach this year. Noah Olsen for the United States. Bjørg van Carl Gudmundsen will be out first for the Europe team. And it's Patrick Vellner, a former competitive gymnast, who will run the first leg for the Canada team. This is an event in which the United States needs to do well as they come in with 0 points. It is hard to make up for a fourth place finish in any event. First leg of the handstand walk course is underway. Again, all four athletes will go through this separately. The team with the fastest cumulative time will win the event. Noah Olsen is out front for the United States. He's working his way through that 90-degree obstacle. If they come down in the middle of an obstacle, they have to retreat to the nearest green cones. Noah Olsen is the only one who has yet to come off of his hands. And he is just about through the slalom. Noah Olsen is going to go unbroken as he is trying to navigate the plate pyramid. Olsen is through, and he will take heat one. Great start for the United States. 40 seconds for Noah Olsen. Bjørg van Gudmundsen in the black is trying to hold off Patrick Vellner in the red for seconds. So Gudmundsen is in, along with Vellner. That was a photo finish. And here comes James Newbery. Now, again, it's the team with the fastest total time, so Noah Olsen has given the United States a nice cushion heading in to their first female athlete.
Olsen doing what I hoped he would do, and he's made me look pretty good.
but he was so fast. It wasn't just a matter of getting through well and making sure he was staying inside those obstacles, but the speed he got through that was unbelievable. 40 seconds is a great start for the US, considering event number one didn't go so well for them. We saw Patrick Vellner break them up, but Noah Olsen, it's just onwards and upwards.
And these athletes only got to get on this course for a handful of minutes. Noah Olsen, when we saw him practice, broke everything up for the most part. Goes completely and totally unbroken through the handstand course and gives himself and his team a nice cushion. 40.42 seconds for Olsen. The Europe team, Bjørgvin Gudmundsen edging out Patrick Vellner for second, and it was James Newberry in fourth, but still three more athletes to go. Rory McKernan is with Noah Olsen.
Noah, you called your shot yesterday. You told me you were going to go unbroken the whole way, but now you've got one event under your belt. Were you nervous coming into this event?
I wouldn't say I was nervous, but there was a little bit of doubt because I wasn't able to make it over the second pyramid yesterday, but today is all that matters, and I was able to do it.
All right, so walk us through the course. How did it play out?
It was quick. It was really, really fast. I know everybody stayed up for at least the first two, and I knew once I could get past four of the arrows, it was the home stretch.
Yeah, you said yesterday you lacked awareness in that, and that's why the last stretch didn't happen for you.
Yeah, absolutely. I wasn't ready for the pyramid to come up, and today I was ready. So that was much-needed points for Team USA.
Indeed it was. Congratulations. Good job, Noah.
Noah Olsen probably did this faster than a lot of people could do it on their feet. That was an incredible effort for him, as he has given his team a nice lead, a 15-second cushion just about, over the Europe team, as the first women now are getting set to take on the handstand walk course. It's Tia Toomey for the Pacific team, Carrie Pierce for the United States, Annie Thorisdottir for the Europe team, and finally, it's Carol Ann Reason-Thibault for the Canada team. But Annie Thorisdottir has done well in events like this in the past.
Annie, exceptional on her hands, and we're going to, I think, see something very similar to what Noah Olsen just did. They don't need to jump up. It is the Europe team. And the crowd really getting on their feet and getting behind Annie.
Annie Thorisdottir's team currently sits in second place in this event, as Gerben Carl Gubinson put up a time of 55.24 seconds. It's the team with the fastest cumulative time that will win this event and lock up 6 points. The second heat is underway. Annie Thorisdottir up and over the first plate pyramid with no trouble. And she is going to continue through the 90 degrees, as is Carrie Pierce. So it's Carrie Pierce and Annie Thorisdottir. Pierce is in the blue shirt, who are in the early lead here. Noah Olsen got Carrie Pierce a nice cushion. So Pierce just needs to have a clean run here if the United States wants to hang on to its lead. Annie Thorisdottir making up ground on Carrie Pierce, but the Americans doing very well so far in this event, as Pierce is through the slalom and now on to the final plate pyramid, and she is not going to come off her hands. Thorisdottir is going to break, so if Pierce doesn't stumble, the United States is going to build on their lead. Pierce is done, and she is in. 50.57 seconds for Carrie Pierce. Annie Thorisdottir is in. Carol Ann Reason-Thibault came off her hands before she completed the slalom. She'll have to go back to the start of that obstacle. That opens the door for Tia Toomey to come in third. Toomey is through. There's a 2-minute cap of this event. If a team does not make it through inside that 2-minute cap, it becomes how many obstacles did they successfully complete. So they will not have a time at the end of the event. They will have a score that indicates the number of successful obstacles. So it's key now for Carol Ann Reason-Thibault to get through inside that 2-minute time cap. We have 20 seconds to go, and Reason-Thibault is on top of the plate pyramid. She is over the line, and she will make it inside the 2-minute time cap. But it's that woman, Carrie Pierce, who wins her heat, 50.5 seconds. And the United States will widen its lead halfway through this second event.
Coming up against Annie, no mean feat. I think the US are on a bit of a mission here after that first event, because both Olsen and Pierce going unbroken. I think that could be the strategy going in, and it is a strength of both of these athletes. Kari, I'm not sure if she was aware of where Annie was at that stage. but both kicking down at the same time. Mid-strategy, coming in to the slalom and making sure getting through that. She was really tight coming through that when Annie was going wide, so that's where she made up her time.
Kerry Pierce just about unbroken through this entire course, and now the United States has an even bigger lead than they did when Noah Olsen left the floor. Kerry Pierce takes the heat, 50.57 seconds. Annie Thorsatter was second, followed by Tia Toomey and Carol Ann Reason Tebow, and Rory McKernan is with Kerry Pierce.
Kerry, you were cutting it close on those corners. What was the strategy there?
Just stay smooth and steady the whole time. Don't try and rush anything, but make as a straight path as possible.
You said you learned a little bit from yesterday's practice, though.
Yeah, yesterday I ended up almost in the Pacific lane, and I didn't know where I was going, so I had to make sure that I stayed in the track today.
Well, you did a fantastic job. Thanks, Kerry.
Thank you.
Kerry Pierce leaving the competition floor as the second set of men, the final set of men now, are on the competition floor, ready to make their run. It's going to be Rob Forte for the Pacific team, Scott Panchik for the Americans, Jason Smith for the Europe team, and Brent Fikowski. And Scott Panchik has a chance to really put the nail in the coffin in this event.
And he's no stranger as well to walking on his hands, doing well over the previous years in 2014 and 2015 at the regionals, finishing top three. Can he back it up now and give him a really big lead?
Third of four heats here in event two, and the United States has the event lead. They have a 21-second cushion on the Europe team. So Panchik coming down just for a second as they reach the 90-degree obstacle. And this is a dead-even heat. Scott Panchik is through the 90 degree along with Jason Smith, Rob Forte, Brent Fikowski, bottom of your screen, continuing to work his way through the slalom. He had the lead, but now Scott Panchik is looking like he's going to catch him. Panchik is in the blue shirt. The key for Scott Panchik, just don't let anybody beat him by more than 21 seconds, and the Americans will have the lead going into the final heat. Panchik is onto the plate pyramid, as is Fikowski, both kicking down. Panchik back up first, working his way over the plate pyramid, and it's 3 for 3 for the United States. Fikowski will be second. Rob Forte trying to catch Jason Smith. This is where Smith struggled in practice. Forte is in. Smith will take fourth. But Scott Panchik trying to make it a clean sweep for the United States in this event, and they need those 6 points badly as they were shut out after event number one.
Wow, 3 from 3 already. Not going so well event one. Event two is right in their wheelhouse, and Panchik just lifting those hands up a little bit more. To the right of the screen is Jason Smith using a really flat palm and straight arm. Panchik just lifting those hands just a little bit more and just relaxing those shoulders a touch. Once he hit the slalom, that's when he really sped up. Really focused this weekend on making sure the US did a really good job, and as team captain, he's doing just that.
Scott Panchik makes it 3 for 3 for the United States in the handstand walk course as he wins his heat. And now the Americans have a huge lead over the rest of the field. The United States, once again, as Scott Panchik leads the way. Brent Fikowski takes second. It's Rob Forte in third. Jason Smith will take fourth. And once again, an American athlete is joining Rory McKernan.
Scott, it looked like you had a very well thought out strategy. Tell us what it was.
Yeah, it was just drop down at the checkpoint and be quick in between, and it paid off.
How aware of you of the other athletes were you?
I took a quick pick.
You got this.
Yes, I can do this. Words are my thing. I took a quick peek to my left and right in between the checkpoints, and then I got it.
All right, secret to the final athlete could be a quick peek.
Scott Panchik's not going to earn any points with his words, but he definitely earns some points with his hands. At least he's trying to, as the Americans now have a 37-second cushion to work with, as Tennille Reed-Burline will be the last woman for the Americans on the course. It will be Carl Webb for the Pacific team, Sarah Sigmund's daughter for the Europeans, and it's Sandra Pacelli for the Canada team. Tenille Reed-Burline, boy, she has got herself quite a lead to work with here. Just needs to make a clean run.
Exactly right. Get under that two-minute time cap, and it should be enough. Yesterday in practice, she was one of the athletes to get right through for her first attempt at it. Is she going to do what the other guys have done and get through in under that sub-minute?
Right now, the United States is staring 6 points in the face as they look to get right back into this competition. Europe currently sits in second. Pacific is in third, and it's Canada in fourth. So Sandra Pacelli needs to push the pace here. Final heat of event two, and it's the United States with a 37-second cushion on the rest of the field as now both Sigmund's daughter and Sandra Pacelli stumbled early, and Tenille Reed-Burline is out in front all by herself as she works her way through the 90 degrees. Carl Webb is in second. She's in the green shirt at the top of your screen. Tenille Reed-Burline taking a break. She just has to make sure that Sarah Sigmund's daughter doesn't beat her by 37 seconds. And right now, it's looking like that will not happen as Tenille Reed-Burline is working her way through the slalom. Carl Webb still sits in second. It's Sarah Sigmund's daughter in the black and Sandra Pacelli in the red, who are now fighting for third. And Tenille Reed-Burline on her last turn through the slalom. And Tenille Reed-Burline with one obstacle to go as the United States looks to win the event and take 6 points. Carl Webb is on to the plate pyramid as well. Tenille Reed-Burline can take her time here again. They have a huge lead to work with, and the Americans will take event two. Carl Webb stumbles. She has to go back to the start of the obstacle. Pacelli at the other end of the floor has caught her. The Pacific team came in second place. They had a 16-second cushion on the Europeans. And now Carl Webb is in. As the Pacific team looks to score 4 points if they can finish in second. Pacelli is really struggling with that plate pyramid again. It's a two-minute time cap. Sandra Pacelli only has 10 seconds left to get in inside that. Sarah Sigmund's daughter is not even to the final obstacle, so it looks like now the score will become the amount of successful obstacles completed for Canada and Europe. So the Pacific team goes first and second. They'll lock up 4 points to increase their total to 10. They will be your leaders after two events, but the United States dug themselves out of an early hole as they will pick up the event win as all four of their athletes win their heats.
What an exceptional performance from the entire team. Coming into the event number two, like, things could have been down, but I'm sure Adam Knife had a quick chat, and as he mentioned before, it was lows and highs and just get out there and do it. And Pierce was so fast through that slalom. And as Adrian Bosman said earlier, that fatigue level coming into that last pyramid was there, but not so much for the American team. They just got through so fast. To Neil Reed, doing exactly what she did in practice yesterday, getting to that last obstacle, stopping, composing herself just a little, and getting down 4 for 4, boom.
And her three teammates did her a huge favor as she ran the anchor leg. The United States locks up 6 points in the event win, and they join Rory McKernan.
All right, Team USA, we went last in the first event, and then you bounced back with this event win. So I have to know from the coach, what did that locker room chat sound like?
It was cool. You know, it wasn't the way we wanted to start, but they responded when they needed to.
What was said? Like, what did you guys decide coming out of the strategy to bounce back from that?
We talked about what we talked about in the warm-up, just let it go and move on to the next one. We all had a different plan for the handstand walk, and we all executed each of our unique plans.
All right, Tenille, all you had to do was finish smoothly, and you almost tripped up in the end. What was going through your head on that last obstacle?
I was like, oh, no, don't let it be me. Don't let it be me that ruins it. But I was just happy I could finish that well for my team.
Well, very impressive from all you guys. Thank you.
The United States picks up their first event win here of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. Noah Olsen started things off with a bang, and the United States goes 4-4-4. Two events down, three events remain. We'll be back with more from the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational from Melbourne, Australia.
Hey, Melbourne, you guys having a good time? Yeah, right on. Hey, we want to talk to you guys who are watching here on Facebook, just to interact with you a little bit, because this is going to Facebook Live, and this is a community event, not just here in the local area, but from you guys at home as well.
Absolutely, and given that we're in the age of technology, we are live with you guys right now on Facebook Live. Rory and I are watching your questions coming through, and we want to hear from you, and we have a special guest that can answer a few questions as well.
Mr. Castro, we got a couple that already came in for you. And in particular, a lot of people asking about the handstand walk event and how you like how it played out. Dan Snook from California actually is up in the middle of the night watching and wants to know, I mean, this is a unique event. How do you like the way that it played out?
Well, I like the way that it played out. It was very exciting. Most of the athletes were able to do it. We only had a couple who couldn't finish it. But really, in the creation of this, we've done handstand walk for distance in a set time. We've done handstand walk unbroken. We've done a set distance and as fast as you can. We've done a lot of different variants of handstand walk. And where would we take it? Where do we go from there? This was kind of the natural next step. You see a lot of athletes doing some of these components, especially the plate walking in their training. And so making a course like this made sense. And I can guarantee you, you'll see more of these in the future. So if you're an athlete, you should probably work on this.
Just a quick follow-up. I mean, how are you feeling about Melbourne so far? How's your visit been?
What'd you say?
How you feel about this area? How you feel about being in Australia?
I like Melbourne. I love it. Thank you guys for being a great host. This has been a wonderful time.
All right, we got one more.
Dave, I have a bit of a cheeky question for you. A question came through from Simone Arthur. Thank you for this question. She says that you mentioned some changes to the season next year. Can you please tell us what they are? Australia doesn't kiss and tell. You can trust us.
Be patient. Be patient.
No?
Patience, my friend.
All right, I think Dave's referring to the cooldown show. We hope you guys will stick around here locally, and we hope that you guys will stay tuned in. Dave is going to talk about some big changes to the CrossFit game season, from what we understand. That's all the details we got. But what else are people saying, man? I see people from Brazil, US.
Did we work out before the event? I don't know if they're talking about us or about the athletes, but as far as I know, the athletes probably took it easy today. I think even yesterday they had a pretty light day. But as for us, yeah, we hit it this morning.
CrossFit Games Athlete Easy is pretty intense.
Yeah.
And I saw a couple of the athletes hitting it yesterday. Camille, she's coaching, but she did a workout with us in the hotel gym yesterday as well.
Yeah.
I got to do the handstand course. I sucked.
Yeah, it looks really challenging. Dave said to me, can you handstand yesterday? And I said, no. It looks like a really tough course.
All right, well, we're glad you guys. Oh, Joel says that he loves us.
Riley
nice.
Says, Straya.
Dave, a guy named Rodrigo Flores called you the devil. He probably doesn't even know you. If Dave had Instagram or Facebook, you guys would be in trouble.
Annette wants to know the tire weight, and I remember there was an ish thrown around for that. Do we know a
definite
weight?
Yeah, I'm going to go, well, in pounds, and you can maybe help me out, but in pounds it was 480 for the women and 711.
Yeah, there's no way that I can help you out with that. Sorry, get your calculators out, guys. Yeah. Divided by
two. Like 212 kilos for women.
So heavy.
And something else for men.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, cool. Hey, keep the questions coming, guys. We're going to have the cool down show, like we mentioned. So we want your questions in there. Maybe we'll get some of the folks in the local area as well. Yep. Pitch some questions at Castro, any of the team members from any of the teams as well.
Bring them on. Bring the questions on. Thanks, guys. See you soon.
Hey, guys. Rory McKernan here to invite you to the CrossFit Liftoff powered by Rogue. Now, 2017 will mark the third year of this competition, and the format could not be simpler. You'll max out your clean and jerk, and you'll max out your snatch. You do one CrossFit Metcon. The competition will begin on November 30th. That's a Thursday. We'll have a live broadcast with top athletes throwing down, and we'll release the CrossFit portion of the workout. You'll have until Monday, that's December 4th, to submit your scores. Scoring for the liftoff works just like it does in the open. You can do your workouts in a registered affiliate in front of a judge and get validated by the affiliate manager, or if you'd rather clang and bang in the privacy of your own home or garage, you can do that and submit a video link of your effort. Unlike any other CrossFit Games competition, the Liftoff has weight classes. There's cash and prizes on the line for heaviest snatch, heaviest clean and jerk, heaviest total, but also pound for pound lifting, as well as the top overall performer. And good news for you masters and teenagers, you'll have your own divisions as well. Two max lifts in a CrossFit workout, why wouldn't you compete? Head to games.crossfit.com for more information and to sign up.
back in Melbourne, Australia, in Margaret Court Arena, where the Pacific team is right where they were after two events last year. They are in the lead with 10 points. The United States sits in second. Canada is in third. And it's Team Europe that sits in fourth. Kayla Banfield is with coach and athlete for the Pacific team, James Newberg.
James, you've been with the Pacific team for a week now. How have you guys spent that last week? It's been quite a fair advantage, I'd say.
The last week that we've been together, we haven't really been working on crazy amounts of fitness or anything like that. It's been more so about just getting to know each other and building more of a rapport and sort of just like working off each other's energy, yeah.
And now I had to pull you off the ground while you were stretching. There's super tight breaks here between events. What are you guys doing in between?
So we're just more talking, like we're still warm from the last event, and basically we're just trying to flow through and just make sure everyone knows exactly what we're doing so our transitions are smooth.
Absolutely. I won't keep you any longer, so good luck for the rest of the day.
Thank you.
James Newbery and the Pacific team getting set for the third of five events. Event three, classic CrossFit couplet, but it has to be synchronized. Bar muscle-ups and then power snatches, six rounds of each. Got to keep an eye on transitions, though, because a lot of times it's what happens in between the movements that makes a huge difference.
Big time. It's not that heavy, so they're going to be moving through those pretty quick, but those transitions get longer and longer. Are they going to be speeding up those transitions as the event progresses?
The Canada team comes in third place overall. They have some work to do to get themselves on top of the overall leaderboard. For more on them, let's send it down to Rory McKernan.
Sean, any event that has hanging from a pull-up bar and working from the hang with the barbell, you know you're going to have to manage your grip. Well, in this event, the women are at a disadvantage because they are using the same barbell as the men. Typically, there's about a 3-millimeter difference in a women's bar. Sounds small, but over the course of this many reps that fast, you could get yourself in trouble. The Canadians said that they're going to break up early and often, mostly to save the grip of Carolan Rizin-Tebow. So keep your eyes on Canada and see if that strategy pays off.
Thank you, Ro. Sandra Bocelli chalking up her bar. Sarah Sigmund's daughter could not finish the handstand walk course. Remember, earlier in the week, she was not feeling well. You have to start wondering whether or not that's still affecting her.
Possibly. Also, the travel time out here. It's a fair way to come out here. Has jet lag played a part in that as well? We'll have to wait and see if she can bounce back.
Synchronization is going to be key for all the teams here. Every single rep needs to be together. Third of five events underway. The athletes know four of them. They do not know what the fifth event is. That will be briefed later. The synchronized bar muscle-ups, every athlete needs to be locked out on top of that bar at exactly the same time for the rep to count. The Pacific team is through their first four, and now it's on to the barbells where they will complete eight hang power snatches, 135 pounds for the men, 95 pounds for the women. That's 61 kilos for the men, 43 kilos for the women.
The more time you spend with people, obviously, the more comfortable you get. And the awareness of where you are in a movement where you don't have to communicate, you can do it by sight, really plays a big factor. It's going to come down to this one, especially Pacific team just moving their bars forward. But these guys have spent so much time over the last week together. Hopefully, they've got everything in queue.
The Europe team yesterday said this event, quote, was their jam. And right now, they are in the lead. There are 72 total reps. The team that is in the lead will have its name highlighted in the blue box at the top of your screen, and the number in the white box will indicate how many repetitions that they have completed. All the other teams, the number in the white box will indicate how many reps behind they are of the leaders. And now, for the second time, the Pacific team in the green shirts, the United States in the blue, the Europeans in the black, and the Canadians all on to their second round of eight synchronized hang power snatches. In order for the rep to count, they need to be locked out overhead in control of the barbell at exactly the same time. Carolan Rizin-Tebow is on the right of your screen. She is the one who was concerned about using a men's barbell, and so far doesn't seem to be affecting her too much, as it's the Pacific team and the Canada team who are first done with round two.
Pacific team breaking that up, splitting half and half, working that grip strategy as Ro mentioned a couple of minutes ago. They're going to make sure there's leaving nothing to chance. When we get into the back end of these six rounds,
Pacific team coming in with a 4-point lead over the United States and Canada for the top spot on the overall leaderboard. They are done with their third round of four synchronized bar muscle-ups.
I mentioned transitions before. The Pacific team top of screen are working really well and not rushing the transition or the setup of their barbells.
Canada team is still in the lead there now through 32 of the 72 total repetitions, but the Pacific team is tied with them. Now the United States has started to catch up, but Canada is back to work, and they are back in the lead. Round three is done for Canada. Round three is done for the Pacific team. Canada in the red, bottom of your screen. Pacific team there in the green at the top. The United States and the blue are now done with their third round, and the Europe team is starting to fall behind. They really thought that this event was going to be in their wheelhouse. This is the fight for first place.
Synchronization for the Pacific team, bottom left. They're the only same team roster that we've seen ever at an invitational. And the communication hasn't been that visual. We can't see too much coming out of anyone's mouth. It's just going by sight at the moment. Save a little bit in the tank and just make sure they've got eyes on each other. A little bit romantic.
James Newbery and Carl Webb are closest to the camera, and then behind them is Rob Forte and the fittest woman on earth, Tia Toomey, and their cycle time is much faster on that barbell than the Canada team. And now Pacific is done with their fourth of six rounds, as is the Canada team. They are leaving both the United States and Europe behind them. An event win here would be huge for the Pacific team, as they would really put a stranglehold on the top spot on that overall leaderboard. The United States is done. They currently sit in third place in this event. They are now back to the pull-up bar for their synchronized bar muscle-ups. But the Canada team, so far, the grip does not seem to be a factor.
Frykowski not only looking straight across at Patrick Vellner to make sure they're all synchronized, but looking down the field and holding his hands up to make sure everyone knows exactly what they're doing and keeping an eye on the Pacific team at the same time.
He was holding up the number two. They did two reps. Now they're going to do three, and they have dropped it. The Pacific team, meanwhile, is now in the lead by one rep. 72 total reps need to be completed in this event. This is the fifth of six rounds. Pacific team continuing to work. And they are done. The Pacific team will move on to their final round, back to the bar for four synchronized bar muscle-ups. Meanwhile, the Europe team is struggling.
Has that come down to the lack of practice that Sarah has missed over the last couple of days? Synchronization just out a little bit, but a great race coming up, and the crowd really getting vocal.
Europe team sits in fourth place right now. The battle for first is between the Pacific team and the Canada team, as they are on the right of your screen. The Pacific team is off first. They'll have six, make that eight hang power snatches in the sixth and final round. So eight reps remaining for the Pacific team, looking for their second event win here in the competition. They're two down as Canada has yet to get to the barbells. Three down now, four down for the Pacific team as they have widened their lead, and now the Canada team is getting to work. The Pacific team still in the lead, looking for their second event win. One more to go. A no rep for the Pacific team. Canada creeping up. But the Pacific team, it will not cost them, and it's a second event win for the Pacific team. Canada, meanwhile, can lock up second place, and that will separate them from the United States on the overall leaderboard if they can hold off the Americans, as they are rep for rep. And now the United States is in second, and Canada will finish in third.
Wow. USA just plugging away there in the middle of the arena and snuck up on Canada to take that second position.
Canada at the last minute goes from second to third, and they were in the lead at one point in this event, and now the Europe team looking to get shut out in this event, as they are the only team left on the floor. A bit surprising, because they were very confident about their chances in this event when it was announced yesterday.
Now that grip I mentioned earlier starting to play a factor, especially with the young ladies. Barbell's a little bit thick because it is a men's bar.
Communication doesn't seem to be as smooth with them either.
No, they just seem to be a little bit off, but they are all done now. And we'll be under that time cap.
The Pacific team over there to congratulate the Europe team as they come across the finish line. So three events and two wins now for Cara Webb and Rob Forte as the Pacific team once again for the second straight year will have the overall lead after three events, but this time it's in front of their home crowd. But this was surprising. The Europe team said this was the one event they had circled, but boy, they struggled from the word go.
Yeah, what's this from the barbell for the first time? They got on and they just seemed a little bit off with the synchronization on the bar muscle-ups. But these guys, the Pacific team, all the way. Everything was so composed. Everything was calm. They knew exactly what they did. And they just punched out exactly what they needed to do. Frykowski, the leader, coming through in event number three, letting them know exactly what they needed to do and making sure he was aware of where every other team was.
United States put on a late charge at the end and will finish second in the event. But the Pacific push allowed them to win their second of three events, and they have widened their overall lead as they get in at 6:09.64. The United States is in second, Canada is in third, and Europe struggling in that event, they take fourth. But this Pacific team has given this crowd a lot to cheer about, and they are with Rory McKernan.
All right, Rob, another event win, but first I got to talk to you about what happened on that last rep.
Well, I got a two-finger hang squat snatch PB, 61 kilos. My grip was just gone. We got a no rep, so I had to go for a fifth rep. And I had nothing left, so I had to get under it. They didn't know I squat snatched it, so they just dropped it, and I'm like, you didn't wait for me. So we had to do another one, but luckily we had 20 seconds to spare, so it was good.
Nicely done. Now, coming in, it looks like I can't see you guys saying anything on the field of play. What is the communication strategy?
There's a lot more to communication than words, that's for sure. And that's something that we've worked on, is actually being able to read each other and understand each other as people and use our body language and that energy to communicate with each other. And that was like Schmidt. That was perfectly executed how we wanted it to.
Well, it's working out very nicely for you. Give it up for Pacific Team.
So far, things playing out like they did last year. The Pacific team with the overall lead through three events as they are now 6 points up on the United States. Canada sits in third, and it's the Europe team, the defending champions, who are in fourth. The big tire getting rolled out next for event four. More from the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational from Margaret Court Arena when we return.
I'm going to go to the next slide.
Mitch, Zeke, you guys are both athletes from our very own country. How are you finding today's event?
It's been incredible so far. The atmosphere in this place is amazing, especially having two wins in a second. Can't really be any happier than that. That's incredible.
What about you, Zeke?
Yeah, it's awesome seeing the Aussie guys just on home soil doing so well so far. It's pretty cool. And I'm sure the crowd's loving it as well. You know, let's bring them home.
Now, Zeke, you've had a few struggles over the last couple of weeks. I only first heard about it a couple of days ago. Tell the guys in the crowd what you've been going through.
So leading into the games, I had a lot of life events going on. So me and my wife gave birth to our son, Zephyr. So that was pretty stressful, going into the games and all that sort of stuff. And then coming home, I think I was just depleted. The season was massive. And then I caught a virus and it just took me down. So I spent 2 weeks in hospital. It's been a bit of a tough road back, and I was forced into a 2-month rest where I didn't do a lot. And I'm just starting to get back into it now. So it's starting to enjoy it and getting ready for the season.
Well, I'm glad to hear you're back on your feet. Mitch, you're from Melbourne. You've had a couple of the teams train at your box, obviously a lot of drop-ins. What's the vibe been like at your box?
Oh, it's been so good. It's been a full house for the last week. So we've had athletes at the top of their game throwing down. We've had all the members who normally only come in the morning in there all day. So yeah, it's been great.
Also, Melbourne, you guys have been amazing. Can I get one more? Aussie, Aussie, Aussie!
McKernan here to invite you to the CrossFit Liftoff powered by Rogue. Now, 2017 will mark the third year of this competition, and the format could not be simpler. You'll max out your clean and jerk, and you'll max out your snatch, and you do one CrossFit MedCon. The competition will begin on November 30th. That's a Thursday. We'll have a live broadcast with top athletes throwing down, and we'll release the CrossFit portion of the workout. You can do your workouts in a registered affiliate in front of a judge and get validated by the affiliate manager, or if you'd rather clang and bang in the privacy of your own home or garage, you can do that and submit a video link of your effort. Unlike any other CrossFit Games competition, the Liftoff has weight classes. There's cash and prizes on the line for heaviest snatch, heaviest clean and jerk, heaviest total, but also pound for pound lifting, as well as the top overall performer. Head to games.crossfit.com for more information and to sign up.
Three events are down here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational, and so far, this Australian crowd has had a lot to cheer about as their team currently sits on top of the overall leaderboard. They have a 6-point lead over the United States. What has impressed you so far about the way the Pacific team has handled these first three events?
Well, they're Aussies for a start, but including that, they just lack of verbal communication. It all seems to be visual at the moment, and they're not spending too much time wasting their voice going through those sort of things. So it's been really good to notice how well they've done each time, and they're just doing so well. But saying that, Last year, the same thing happened, but can they back it up for the next couple of events?
It really looks like they've had a plan going into all these events too, and they've really executed perfectly.
It's been perfect. USA team, the handstand walk, we knew it was going to be a strength with the first three, not so much Tennille, but she showed us yesterday in practice how good she was, but 4 from 4 for the US. They lack a little bit of experience at Invitational, but Adam Knife is doing a wonderful job.
And then in event three, we saw a great battle between the Pacific team and the Canadians for the lead early on. And once again, you mentioned it, that just nonverbal communication seemed to really push them over the finish line.
They just did so well, and they knew exactly what they had to do to execute. And they've done that for the last three events, and let's hope they can continue on for the last two.
Three events are down. Event number 4 is next, and this one was just announced right before the competition. It is a partner tire flip. Rory McKernan is on the competition floor with more on what awaits the athletes here in the next event.
Sean, Canada has an unfortunate history with flipping things in this particular competition. In 2014, they were in the lead by 3 points before Tire buried their dreams. Again, last year, they had trouble with the pig, which put them in a deficit from which they never recovered. Now, the tires are smaller this year, but don't take that to mean that they're small. These things are behemoths. Check these things out. For the women alone, 480 pounds. I'm a 6'2" male. This thing is huge. We'll see if they've gotten better at this event and if they can shake the monkey off their back.
Thank you, Ro. The Canada team has had trouble, as you said, with those implements, and it has kept them from ever winning the Invitational. The men will be up first. They have to alternate every time for the first minute. This is for total reps for the 4 athletes. After 1 minute, they can go in any order they want. Athletes can flip 1, 2, or 3 times. There's no requirement to alternate. The male tire weighs 712 pounds. That's about 323 kilos. The strength, obviously, very important here, Jeremy, but technique on the tire is key.
Without a doubt. We teach this in the CrossFit Strongman Seminar also. It's not about having to lift the tire per se as a deadlift, but driving that tire and getting a good purchase with those shoulders and wrapping those arms around and using those hips to full extension and then getting underneath it and not lifting the tire, but making sure you've got enough hip extension and enough momentum to get that tire up and over.
Canada is in the lead, and they have already gotten down the floor once. Again, this is not for distance. This is for total repetitions. They are through 9 total reps. The Pacific team is just 2 back, and Brent Fikowski, the biggest guy in the whole field here, not having a whole lot of trouble with that tire.
He's not. He's using those long levers to get underneath. What I'd like him and Patrick Vellner to do is get that front foot planted a little bit more underneath that tire. Because once it hits that toe, you've got too much sway of that tire because it is a heavy implement. So that foot underneath, bottom of the screen, you can see Patrick Vellner struggling a little with that foot on their toe hitting the ground rather than planting that foot. But Fikowski and Vellner plowing ahead.
And they're still alternating. We are in the second minute, which means they can go in any order they want. And they're going to make a trip up and back. With just 3 seconds to go, Vellner doesn't look like he's going to give it another try, but Canada smoking through that, and they have handed quite the lead over to Sandra Pacelli and Carol Ann Reason-Tebow. They have 18 total reps. Now, Reason-Tebow and Pacelli's total will be added to that. Newbery and Forte doing some good work for the Pacific team. Looking to keep their team on top of the overall leaderboard. They came in with a 6-point lead over the United States.
Gee, they were consistent right through that. Just going rep for rep from the start. Fikowski even jumping in for a double at a couple of stages throughout that 2 minutes. And yeah, 2 seconds to go on the clock and they're happy. Great lead for them, leading in to the 2 female athletes.
Rob Forte and James Newbery for the Pacific team. They were able to move, but certainly not as quickly as the Canadians.
You noted James lifting that tire a little bit too much. It'd be great to get him driving in a little bit more.
It's the Canada team with the early lead thanks to Patrick Vellner and Brent Fikowski, and they are standing by with Rory McKernan.
rent an event like this, it seems like the strategy would just be go. But what did you guys plan for before you went into it?
Go. I'm a little more comfortable on this, so I knew I'd take a double in the second minute at some point. But Pat was doing just fine, so we just pretty much alternated after that.
What'd you tell the women going into this now?
We were going to try to give them a buffer as best we could. And we know they're going to be good at this as well. So we just told them to don't get frustrated and don't hesitate and just go for it.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Sandra Pacelli and Carol Ann Rees and Tebow have a 5-rep lead over the rest of the field. Annie Thorosauter and Sarah Sigmundsdottir will be up for the Europe team, and they have some work to do. They need an event win to keep themselves in contention here. The second heat is underway. And the Canadian women were handed a total of 18 reps. They were 5 up on the rest of the field.
Carol Ann Rees and Tebow flipping the tire over. And if you notice, with Alessandra Pacelli, she is getting a lot of hip extension and it is bouncing off her leg as the tire comes up. This next rep, she'll set up really strong and it will pop off that leg, which is making it so much easier to flip straight over.
Canada now has 25 total reps. Europe is in second place. That's good news for them. The Pacific team is in third and the United States is in fourth. The United States team cannot afford another fourth place finish in an event. That would pretty much knock them out of competition for the top spot on the overall leaderboard. They got a lot of ground to make up here as they are 8 reps back of the leaders. Sandra Pacelli and Carol Ann Rees and Tebow have turned back. And now Pacelli can get to work as we are in the second minute.
Annie going over. You just watch Sarah's setup. She lifts it. She's lifting it a bit too much with those hips on the way up first rather than her chest. She gets that chest up a little bit more. That's going to be way more efficient and a lot less fatiguing to get it over.
Someone forgot to tell Canada that they do not do well in these events because right now they are in the lead. Carol Ann Rees and Tebow struggling a bit as Europe is 4 back. The Pacific team is in third. The United States in the blue, they are in serious trouble right now. They are in fourth place and Kerry Pierce can't flip it. Tennille Reed-Burline is back on it. And it's not going to matter, though, because the Americans will once again finish last in the event. Canada, though, picks up their first event win in an event that they were not supposed to do well in. So plenty of surprises here at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational as Canada keeps their title hopes alive. Europe finishes in second. They needed that. The Pacific team suffers their worst finish so far as they're in third, and it's the United States in fourth.
A lot of different techniques used throughout that event, but efficiency was definitely the key. Great start from Fukowski and Patrick Vellner.
We just have one event to go here. And the Americans may be out of contention for the top spot on the overall leaderboard, and their women struggled with this tire, as did the men. Neither pair really having a whole lot of success.
The problem with the tire being so low to the ground, it's so much harder to get a start to lift it off the ground. So that's why it's really important to get a lower setup. And Pacelli did that so well, and the extension of those hips made that roll over of the tire so much easier.
Final results from event number 4. Canada, with 40 total reps, will get the event win. Europe is in second. The Pacific team, that's their worst finish of the competition. And once again, the United States finishing in last place, so they will receive 0 points. Canada locks up 6, and they needed that. They weren't supposed to do well in this event. They proved a lot of people wrong, and Rory McKernan is with the Canada team.
All right, Carol Ann, lots of eyes were on you. Last year you had trouble with the pig, so I got to know what you've been doing for the past year to get so good.
I did pig and tire flip.
Well, it was very effective. Sandra, I saw you did 4 in a row at one point. I mean, is this just your event?
Yeah, this is definitely my specialty, all the strongman stuff, but just wanted to make up from last event, and just went angry Canadian on everyone.
Pat, you guys staging a comeback. How do you like this potential for this last event? What do you want to see?
I mean, anything you can't prepare for is fun for us. So I think we haven't done much squatting yet, so I think everyone kind of sees that coming. So we're excited. We're ready for whatever comes up. So I think bring it on.
All right, thank you. Team Canada.
The Canada team with their first event win of the competition, and it came at the perfect time for them as we have just one event to go. Brent Pekowski and Patrick Vellner setting the table, and then Sandra Pacelli bringing it home. Final event coming up at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational.
Check.
Back at Margaret Court Arena in Melbourne, Australia, where the Pacific team has the lead. There's one event to go. Dave Castro has the official announcement.
Australia, let's give these athletes a huge round of applause for the effort they've put up at this point. They have one more test remaining, and it's a combination of movements that we have used twice this year in team competitions. And we have used it plenty of other time in individual competitions. The thruster and the burpee. Worm thrusters, of course, and synchronized burpees. The rep scheme is classic CrossFit, 21, 15, 9. Worm thrusters, synchronized burpees. That's it. You guys ready to rock and roll? Let's do it. You guys have an opportunity to practice right now with the worms. This will go down in about 12 minutes.
Thrusters and burpees, a combination nobody ever wants to hear. They have to do it with the worm. They all have to be synchronized, and they only have 13 minutes now to figure this whole thing out.
This is where maybe the time that the Pacific team have spent together over the last week is going to play into their hands and make sure that they know exactly how to strategize this event coming up.
The worm weighs 378 pounds, and they have to move it from station to station. That's another thing we have to think about. You and I had a chance to kind of do this with a group of five other people, and it was extremely difficult. Then they have to move it an extra time there at the end just for another little twist of the knife. And again, we talked about transitions, but that's going to be very important.
Oh, very much so. And it's going to come down to pretty much who wants this win. Who's going to take it? Because this is a very nasty couplet. And as you, Dave mentioned, or you mentioned, sorry, we don't want to see this ever come up. So, and for this, especially with the fatigue that these athletes already have, I don't know who is going to take this, but it is going to come down to this last event.
Head judge Adrian Bosman is briefing the athletes on the movement standards. After that, they'll have to come up with a strategy for the final event of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational as the Pacific team looks to win this thing for the first time. We'll be back.
We're gonna clear a compound. Next thing I know, I step on IED. My anger brought me into the box. It was therapeutic for me. I saw the community coming together, cheering you on, the camaraderie. It felt like, you know, being back with the unit. I needed to give back. So I figured, what if I just show people what I do? You know, try to motivate them in my own way. I had a goal to run the Boston Marathon. Running with the flag, it was in honor of my brothers that I served with in Afghanistan. I wanted to show them, hey, we're still fighting. Through tragedy comes great strength.
Every year the crowd sort of picks its favorite. I think this man is in the running.
4 years I'm gonna be 60. Like, what does that even mean? Because at 60, I mean, I feel like I'm even gonna be better at 60 with CrossFit.
Yeah, I think it was something like 2.5, 3 years ago, my mom was still a smoker. And her life was just very different then.
When the huge increase took place was when I changed my diet to the zone diet. When I was really looking to that idea of I'm going to use food as fuel for my body.
I now weigh probably what I weigh all in my 20s. But what happened in those 3 months, I lost 30 pounds.
It changes. It just changes that entire perspective of aging. I guess I don't feel like I'm aging anymore. I recognize that I've been alive for 56 years, but that's all it means to me today. Like, it doesn't mean I'm old at all.
This is a story about a man whose entire life has been devoted to his sport.
I have been on skates for 32 years. I started skating when I was 2 years old. I started playing organized hockey when I was 5. I made the NHL at the age of 20 and have been playing the last 14 years. It's now a league of 22 to 26 year olds are the most dominant players. So I'm on the wrong side of 26.
When we first met, he's had a bucket list. One of his bucket list moments was that he would finish hockey on his terms.
I think more often than not, the sport is usually done with an individual before the individual is done with the sport.
So in the twilight of his career, the question remains, what is it that defines Brooks Like?
We found out we were pregnant with Ava, and I really buckled down at that point. I mean, I knew that having a healthy baby relied on my ability to stick to it. And then after we had her, she was, of course, perfectly healthy. And as she got older, I just saw how much she loved moving her body. And it kind of helped me reconnect. And I thought, man, I remember being a really physical kid. I loved sports. I loved being outdoors and doing things with my body. And I missed that. And I thought, you know, I don't want her to remember me as the mom that can't fit in the booth at the restaurant. I don't want her to remember me as the mom that can't fit in an airplane seat. I want her to remember me as a strong, capable mother. I think that's what I want her to know. Yeah. Jeez.
Melbourne, Australia, the site of the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational, and the home team is one event away from winning it all. The Pacific team with a 4-point lead over Canada. The United States is in third. Europe is in fourth. And once again, it's going to come down to the final event in 2014 in San Jose, California. The United States had a huge comeback as they clinched the victory on the final event. Then in Madrid, Spain, the same thing. Dan Bailey, Margo Alvarez, China Cho, and Rich Froning on the final event got their second straight victory. Then last year in Oshawa, Ontario, Canada, the Americans ran into some trouble on the final event, and that opened the door for the Europe team to win the Invitational for the first time. as Lucas Hogberg, Catherine David's daughter, Sarah Sigmund's daughter, and Bjorven Carl Gubinson took the entire thing. And right now, it's that team, the Pacific team, that controls their own destiny. They just need to finish second or better in this final event to win the Invitational.
I'm 100% that this crowd is going to try and bring this team home. The pressure is on, but if anyone knows pressure, it is Tia Claire Toomey and Kara Webb.
Event 5 was just announced minutes ago, the first time in the Invitational that has ever been done. It is 21:15-9 of worm thrusters and synchronized burpees over the worm that weighs 378 pounds. There's a 100-pound section at the front, an 80-pound section, followed by a 100-pound section and an 80-pound section, and then there are 3 6-pound sections in between those.
It's miserable. And coming down the floor, they're going to obviously break up the thrusters and the burpees, but they've got an extra drop in the last 9 where they've got to move it an extra section.
The Canada team is in second place. They're the only other team right now that has a chance to win. In order for that to happen, they need to win this event to earn 8 points. And the Pacific team would need to finish third or lower. The scoring is a little different for this final event to put more weight on it. The winner gets 8 points. Second place will get 5. Third place will receive 2. And fourth place will receive none. What's going through the head of the Pacific team right now?
Win at all costs. The crowd is here. We're on home soil. They need, if they're going to bring it at any stage, they didn't do it last year with that great lead. They've had great 4 events coming into this. They need to match it and go over that line first.
They have never won the Invitational. They have never finished better than third. They are 1 event away from being crowned Invitational champions in front of their home crowd. We are underway. Who wants it more, the Pacific team or the Canada team? They are on opposite ends of the floor. It will be hard for them to keep an eye on each other. On the worm thruster, they need to squat below parallel and then move that worm to the opposite shoulder for the rep to count. They have to perform 21 before they move on to the synchronized burpees. First place on the left, that's the Pacific team. Second place on the right, Canada. They are just 4 points back. The Americans, meanwhile, the best they can do is second place overall.
They are the only team dropping straight into that squat, getting a no rep there, but every other team had stopped at the shoulder before they descended into the squat. The USA were the only team to drop straight into it. And will that extra pickup of that worm be crucial in the back end of this event?
They have fallen off the pace after they had to drop it. And you can see it's all over the place, so they need to be synchronized at the bottom. And believe me, that is a lot harder than it looks. The Canada team is first done. The Pacific team is right behind them. So Canada needs Europe or the United States to get in between them and the Pacific team if they want to win the Invitational. They have also never won the Invitational. So one thing is for sure, a team that has never won is going to be crowned champions here at Margaret Court Arena in Melbourne, Australia. The Pacific team is in the lead. There are 90 total repetitions. They are through 28 of those. The United States continues to struggle. They just got hit with a no rep.
And this is where it starts to get a little bit spicy, especially for those legs. We mentioned the weight of this worm, and it's not pleasant, even with more than 4 people. These guys are elite athletes, but it is still going to be controlling it. That accumulated fatigue that they've had over the previous 4 events.
Canada is staying close to the Pacific team, but they not only need to beat them, but they need to hope that Europe or the United States can overtake them here in this event. And right now, that is not happening, as Europe is now 8 points or 8 reps off the lead. The United States is 11, and the Pacific team we'll now move on to the round of 15. 15 worm thrusters. Again, the worm weighing 378 pounds.
The Pacific team's got a little bit of a benefit with this because they're roughly all about the same size. The other teams, Brent Fikowski, very, very tall. But these 4, not calling them short or anything, but they're all relatively the same size, which makes a movement such as a thruster, especially getting the worm over the head, a lot easier.
And now Canada's run into some problems. They just got hit with a no rep And here comes the Europe team. They have now moved into the round of 15, so Canada needs to get themselves sorted out as the Pacific team marches up for 15 synchronized worm burpees. And they are leaving little doubt right now. They don't want help from anybody. They want to do this thing themselves. They win it all.
Still moving really steadily through these, not rushing anything, making sure they're hitting the ground at the same time. Tia and Rob in the center, actually having something to say to each other on the way over on those burpees. So just making sure the communication is still there, even at this latter stage of the five events.
And this is where the home field advantage really comes into play. Remember, the Pacific team have been together for more than a week. They've been practicing these types of movements. And they have the advantage clearly here as they are leaving Canada in the dust. They are now 10 reps ahead of them, 90 total reps. And it will be 9 worm thrusters after this, followed by 9 synchronized burpees. And the Pacific team will move on for their 9 worm thrusters. And they are marching closer to their first ever invitational win in front of their home crowd.
Crowd starting to get on their feet. But keep in mind, 9 thrusters will be happening here, but they must break up the last 9 into 2 sets, 1-5 and 1-4 for the burpee. So they've got to move the worm just a little extra before they can get over that finish line.
James Newbury communicating with the team as they drop the worm and get right to work. As they have just 7 reps remaining. The Pacific team coming into this Invitational had never done better than 3rd. That's going to change in a big way as they now have to move the worm one final time and complete 4 synchronized worm burpees. They just got hit with a no rep because they weren't on the bottom at the same time. It's not going to matter. This is now a victory lap. One rep remains. Aussie. The Pacific team has won the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational.
I can't tell you how excited I am right now. What an amazing performance from the repeat team coming back again from last year. What a great year these athletes have had.
All Tia Toomey does is win, apparently. She's coming off the championship of the CrossFit Games, an emotional win there in Madison, and now an emotional win here in front of her home crowd as the Pacific team wraps up its first Invitational Championship. The Canada team is trying to lock up 2nd place. Europe has now passed the United States in this event. Patrick Felder trying to get the crowd fired up a little bit as they continue to have a good time. And the Canadians are in. And they look like they have locked up 2nd place overall.
Great comeback from Canada, especially after last year's results. That experience with the team, especially with Felder Fikowski. Celebrations going on as Europe are about to finish off their last set.
The Europe team came in as the defending champions, and they just could not duplicate that success here again this year. The United States will once again finish last in the event. They had 3 last place finishes, and they are in danger of hitting the time cap here. The Pacific team and the Europe team congratulating each other, and the Americans have just had one heck of a time dealing with that worm. They have 4 synchronized worm burpees to go, and that will wrap up the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational. The Americans continue to work, and they are done. The United States has won 3 Invitationals. Pacific team, they have now won their first, and what a way to do it here in front of their home crowd. I mean, Jeremy, you could not have written a better script.
I cannot believe it.
green and gold. They've gone for gold this afternoon. Dia Claire Toomey, first woman on Earth this year, and now backing it up as part of the team to take out the Invitational.
Final results from event five. Man, Pacific Team just smoked Canada by nearly a minute, and the United States just could not figure out the worm.
Yeah, they were looking so strong so early, and then the wheels just started to fall off. Canada with a very early lead, and Belna Fakowski just showing the way with that communication. But I think it was just accumulation of fatigue over the five events, and just the wheels just started to fall off. Experience with the worm throughout this entire five event. Like, it came down to who had more experience on it, and it was these guys. They've been practicing with it all week. They're the same team from last year. They were on home soil. The crowd's loud. It's just awesome. And what a great result.
The Pacific Team, led by James Newbury, they win the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational, the first time they have ever done that. Tia Toomey and Carl Webb, they had a great battle in Madison at the 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games. Today, they're teammates, and they lead their squad to victory. Dave Castro is on the competition floor, and he will make it official. The Pacific Team, they're the champs.
Ladies and gentlemen, your 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational champions, Team Pacific!
It's the first time they've won, and this is the first time I think I've ever seen somebody celebrate by drinking out of a shoe.
Have you not heard of shoeys?
I have not heard of shoeys.
Oh, it's an Aussie tradition to do a shoey, and the shoes go into the crowd. Yeah, we'll drink out of anything down here.
That's going to be one sought-after shoe that they're flinging into the crowd. Newbury flinging both of his in.
But Daniel Ricciardo does it at the Formula One, gets on the podium and does a shoey. But great to see these guys doing the shoey here at Margaret Court Arena. We're full of surprises.
The Pacific Team, what a way to do it in front of their home crowd. We talked at the beginning of the show here that this was their best chance. They had all four members back from last year. They had the two top fittest women on Earth, and they had this crowd behind them. Perfect storm.
What a great result. You couldn't have scripted it better. You couldn't have scripted it better, especially for the two girls, Tia and Cara.
Well, the shoeys are done. Now it's time for the interview, and Rory McKernan is with the Pacific Team.
All right, Tia, you guys, the Pacific Team has never finished better than third in this event. It's got the same roster as last year, so what changed?
Oh, I don't know, but 2017 is Australia's year.
That is certainly the truth. Rob, you've been around for a minute. You've got the two fittest women on Earth, now an Invitational win on home soil. What does this mean for CrossFit in Australia?
I think it's huge. The girls, what they did for CrossFit in Australia is massive this year, and this just topped it off for sure. Yeah.
All right, I think I kind of know the answer because I saw you drinking out of your shoes, but what do we do to celebrate now, Cara?
What am I going to celebrate?
How do we celebrate? I mean, you've already started, but...
There's only one way an Aussie celebrates.
And John Farnham.
Johnny Farnham, bulk drinks, and a few more shoeys.
Give it up, guys. Team Pacific, your Invitational champions.
Pacific team, for the first time, leaves the Invitational as champions. Jeremy, we started the show and I asked you, what does it mean to have this event here? Now, what does it mean to have the champions of the Invitational here?
It means we've got to bring the Invitational here every year. If this is the result, we need to bring it back down under every year. What a great result from these four, and I'm sure they are going to be celebrating tonight.
Tia Toomey, Cara Webb, Rob Forte, and James Newbery, the Pacific team, your 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational champions. 26 points as they edge out Canada, the United States, and Europe. It has been an absolute blast here in Melbourne, Australia. Hope to do it again next year as the Pacific team will be back to defend their titles. For Jeremy Austin, Rory McKernan, and Caleb Banfield, I'm Sean Woodland. Thanks for joining us. The 2017 Reebok CrossFit Invitational is brought to you by Reebok, the exclusive outfitter of CrossFit and the CrossFit Games. By Arosti, the official athlete care provider for the CrossFit Games with over 150 locations nationwide. After five events, it's the Pacific team that stands atop the overall leaderboard with 26 total points as they take the Invitational for the first time. Jeremy, what impressed you the most about this Pacific team?
Their composure, the way they gelled, like every aspect of every event they were on song, which was just really impressive to see. The most time they spent together.
Okay, no worries. After five events, it's the Pacific team that stands atop the overall leaderboard as they win the Invitational for the very first time. I'm Sean Woodland alongside Jeremy Austin. And Jeremy, what impressed you the most about what was an extremely impressive performance from this Pacific team?
Their composure and everything they did, they gelled so well together. They were just so comfortable with each other. The communication just really wasn't there because they just used a lot of visual communication. So they just worked so well as a four. It was really great to see.
And really, from the get-go, they looked like the team that had the best composure, the best communication, and the best overall plan.
Oh, the strategy came into it, and I spoke to Rob a couple of days ago about the strategy. They had everything worked out to the T. They wanted to get a really good start like they did last year, but they wanted to maintain that. And you mentioned composure. That's all it was. Nothing was rushed. Everything was organized. And communication, it was just so simple but so effective.
The Pacific team took event one just like they did last year. And then the Americans made a big comeback in event two. They win the event, the handstand walk course, and all of a sudden we're thinking, okay, maybe we're going to have a competition, but the Pacific team put the hammer down and never relinquished the top spot on the overall leaderboard.
They did. We're really surprised that they stayed in touch as much as they did, but we spoke about the composure and how well these four gel as a team. The synchronization was off the charts. Everything was just perfect the entire time. As I mentioned, nothing was rushed, everything down to every rep, every second.
Event four, this was probably the biggest surprise of the competition. Canada has usually struggled with these sorts of implements, but they came out and they won the event thanks to the finish that Sandra Pacelli put on that.
And then it came down to event number five, the crowd bringing them home here at Margaret Court Arena. They didn't go out too quick, but they made up time at the back end. And once that crowd got involved, it was all guns blazing. And it was a great result for the Pacific team.
And then Rob Forte putting the exclamation point on it with what is called, for our non-Australian viewers, a shoey. I asked you at the top of the show, you know, what it meant to have this event here. What does this mean for the country of Australia to have the Invitational Champions?
I'm sure it's just going to spur more people on to get involved in CrossFit from like affiliate level all the way up. So hopefully we get a good influx of people at the Open next year. But great things for Australia and the Pacific Regional.
For the first time, the Pacific team will be the defending champions next year at the Invitational. It was a total blast here in Melbourne, Australia. We can't wait to see all of you again. A great show put on by the Pacific team, the Europe team, the Canadians, and the Americans. For Jeremy Austin, Caleb Banfield, and Rory McKernan, I'm Sean Woodland. Thanks for joining us here in the Land Down Under.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, thank you all for sticking around here, the local crowd in Melbourne, and thank you all at home for joining us. This is the Cool Down Show. In just a few moments, Dave Castro is going to give us some exciting information. But first, I want to catch up with the runner-ups from this year's event. Brent Fikowski, going back, looking at the competition, this was a great comeback from last year. Anything that you would change from this year's competition?
I think we made a couple small mistakes, but overall, we gel well as a team. Sorry, there's an echo. We gel well as a team, and we could have changed a few things, but I think Australia was the best team here, and they showed it.
Yeah, right on. Alessandra, rookie on the team, tell me about your experience of this versus competing as an individual.
It just feels a lot different being on a team. You really have to learn how to synchronize with people, and I think it's been a great experience, something I have been looking forward to do a long time. So.
All right, I gotta ask Sarah Sigma's daughter. You didn't look like yourself tonight. We all knew that you were sick earlier in the week, but tell us how you felt tonight, going 100%.
I was in denial before I started. I was like, damn, I feel good, like mirroring myself, like, yeah, I can do this. And then after the bar muscle up and hang power snatch, kept hitting my stomach and like almost throwing up. So I hit a wall there, and I feel pretty terrible right now, again.
They still love you. Annie T, what was it like to be back on an invitational team here in Australia?
Well, I've always wanted to go to Australia, so this has been an awesome experience for me. Thanks. It obviously sucked for the past 2 years not being able to be a part of the team. Also, haven't been a part of it 2 or 3 years continuous before that. So I'm super happy to be back here, and I'm gonna have to fight for my spot next year. I know we have a good competition from Europe and from the Icelandic girls, so I'm just super proud to be a part of this team.
Right on, we're glad you're here. All right, Sam Briggs, you were very mellow. Like some of the other coaches, a little bit emotional. You were pretty chill over there. I know that you wanted to get on the competition floor yourself, but it's the second time as a coach. Thinking back, third time as a coach, pardon me. Looking back on the competition, what would you change?
Nothing. They gave everything, and that's all I could ask as a coach. And then we'll come back next year and win.
Should we expect you back as a coach or as an athlete?
I'd like to be back as an athlete, but I think I'll hopefully be invited back as a coach if I'm not.
Those are two pretty good choices. Cammie, let's talk to you about your recovery.
Okay.
Guys, give it up for CLB. She's had to drop out of this year's games. You're 10 weeks post-operation now, so how's recovery going?
I mean, it's going pretty well when you're in Australia with all of you guys. Yep.
That's all we get? That's all we get?
I'm happy to be here, so it's good. And I'm moving, almost there.
Yeah. All right, Pat Vellner. I don't know where to go with that. Hey, special moment for you at the dinner the other night. You got the third place trophy. What did that feel like? How about stand up? How about give it up for Pat Vellner, third fittest man on earth?
Pretty much says it right there. Like, it means a lot to have the way we had it at the dinner and do that in front of our peers and have that recognized. And the reception you get in Australia for what happened just really speaks a lot to the caliber of people we have here and the sport culture that exists in Australia. So I appreciate you guys and everything that happened in spite of everything.
All right. Three event wins from the Aussies. So we've heard from you guys a little bit. Can we get to the Americans first and we'll finish on you guys? Lots and lots of rookies on the USA team. So, Tennille, first you, it was interesting to hear you say you're glad you're not a team member. You actually think it's harder than competing as an individual. Tell me about that.
No, I definitely think it's harder to be on a team now, but I couldn't be more honored to be on the USA team and represent the US.
Yeah. Scott, you've been in this game for a minute. How is this different from the other events that you've been a part of for CrossFit?
It was special. Like Tennille said, being on a team is different. I have a huge respect for all the teams that compete at the CrossFit Games. But there were some special moments and some great tests that showcased all of our abilities.
Right on. Well, I think Dave is... Yeah, thank you. Yeah, let's talk to the Aussies real quick. Let's just get you guys to hype the crowd one more time. I think we've heard... You guys got a microphone? Cool. So just one more time. What does it mean for you guys now that you've kind of had a minute to chill out? You're not drinking out of shoes anymore. You can kind of take in the moment. What does this mean for you guys? I don't get down here for the regionals very often. This crowd is amazing. But just to get this win, and of course, you two had an amazing year.
We sure did. It's been an amazing year, I think, for both of us and for the Aussies in general. Being here was epic. Like I said, we had to remind ourselves quite often to appreciate what we actually had. This is also the first time we haven't had to travel so far. Now everyone kind of knows how shit it is. It's terrible. And so that was really nice. We got to just kind of hang out and live at Rob's house for a while and be an inconvenience to him just for a couple of days before this. But this was just the icing on the cake for the Aussies and especially for Tia and I, and being able to share that with two amazing guys. It was epic.
I have a question for James, the coach. He mentioned to me a moment ago that these guys do so well without actually verbally communicating to each other. And that just blew my mind. Like, how you talk to one another without verbally communicating, I really want to hear more about that, because that's insane.
Yeah, for sure. Like, when we first got here, our first training session that we did, Rob sort of sat us down and he sort of said, this year, let's build on last year as much as we can. And that was, hey, guys, we want to try and bounce off each other's energy just by having a quick glance at the other athletes' faces and seeing how they're doing and how fast they're breathing. And we can tell a lot from that now. And after last year experiencing it, we had a lot of calls and we wanted to condense it down and save energy. And that's exactly what we did. We could look across and see how everyone's moving and how fast they were moving and how efficient they looked, and just react to that and build on that without actually having to talk to each other.
Tia, let's just wrap up Pacific Team. What would a perfect 2018 look like for you after this year?
Well, I hope it goes the same. Sorry, guys. No, but definitely, you know, 2017 has been such a year for myself and also for the Aussies. But leading into next year, it's a new game. Everyone starts at zero and it's game time when it comes to opens, regionals, the games, and then invitationals again. So it's a level playing field and we've just got to go and train harder than ever and have more fun than ever.
Right on. Let's give it up for all these athletes, guys. Oh, one more.
Hello.
Hi.
So I just wanted to say thank you to Dave and all of his CrossFit team, and that's obviously including the volunteers as well from Australia. But thank you so much for giving us the opportunity to bring it home to Australia. It really, really means a lot to us, and to be able to do it in front of you guys. And then I'm going to definitely keep it short and sweet before I start ugly crying again. But thank you so much. If it wasn't for you all coming here today and having the support from all the other Aussies, we wouldn't have been able to get through it. So thank you very much to everyone.
All right, you guys ready to hear some news from Dave Castro, I think.
So thank you guys. You guys were amazing. The energy here was incredible. Nice shirt up there. The Dave Castro is a prick. I like it. The energy here was amazing. You guys have been a great host city and a great host country. We really appreciate it. And this has been an amazing invitational for us. So you guys highlight them. Show the shirt. What did you guys think of the four-person worm? Did you guys like it? That wasn't a one-off, that wasn't a gimmick. The four-person worm was an introduction to the four-person format that we are gonna move forward with at the regionals and the games in the following years. We are reducing the number of members on a team to four. So regionals next year, games, there'll be four-person teams, not six-person teams. That's one of our big announcements for tonight.
This might, I just have to ask why. Why are we going from six to four?
Over the course of the last few years, the Invitational has been four people, and we've seen a lot. We get a lot of feedback from that, the experience of programming for this, the results we get back from these athletes. It's so much cleaner. It's easier to program for. It's a better visual, even. It's not so many people out on the field. There's still tight teams. I think when we get to regionals and games, we're going to be able to highlight the athletes a little more than just the team. Our commentators, our fans, it'll be easy to follow four individuals on a team rather than six. Six kind of drowns out the entire team. Programming, it'll be better programming for the teams at regionals and at the games. And then at the games, the things we can do with a team of four, the sky's the limit. They're gonna get better tests. They're gonna be well-rounded, complete. And I'm really excited about bringing the four-person format. And again, this has kind of been a test bed for it for the past few years, doing the four-person here. We used to do this as a six-person event. Then a couple of years in, we reduced it to four, and it's such a better format.
Okay, so is that the announcement about regionals as well? Because that affects regionals and games, or is there something more on regionals?
One last thing on this, and I think the level of teams that we'll get at the regionals from this format will be much higher, because it's easier for a gym to find four really good athletes versus finding six really good athletes. So I'm excited about that. Some affiliate teams are going to put up teams as good as some of these other super teams out there, and we'll see a lot of new faces. Annie asked me the other day, she said, are you guys going to reduce the team size? Because if you do, I'm going to go team. You said, okay. Okay, she's thinking about going team. Well, that would be cool. I'd be excited to see you compete with a team from Iceland. The other big change is we've taken a look at the numbers in the open, and we've taken a look at the regionals and how we do it. And based off of number of participants for regions, there's a disparity in certain areas. For example, one of the top registered regions in the world or areas is South America. And based off of that, kind of choosing this path of basing our regional decisions off of numbers of open participants, we're gonna shuffle up the regionals a little. And some of the big changes look like South America having their own regional. So South America is gonna get pulled from the South, and they're gonna have their own regional this year. And Brazil was like the number third highest country for registrants in the world for the Open last year. And so, you know, there's a significant community there, a significant number of people doing CrossFit. Other changes, so the South is free. They have their own region still. Canada West, and California are all getting combined into one regional. So that changes the game for a lot of people in that area. Again, Canada West, the Northwest essentially, and California are all going to be combined into one regional. And that affects this gentleman
here. You got an eyebrow raise over here from Brent Fikowski. What's your initial reaction?
Yeah, that's good.
Well, that was easy.
That's the answer he needs to give, because he knows no matter how it's structured, he's still going to be at the top and he's still going to get to the games. And that's the confidence I like in him. What a stud. North America, the rest of North America basically stays the same. And then going across, let's talk about this actually. The Pacific and Asia is going to stay the same for this year. There's no big changes to this regional. Taking a look at Europe, we're actually going to break it into two regionals. So Europe is going to get broken into two. and what that's gonna look like, Southern Europe, and what essentially is the areas of South Africa and the Middle East, they're gonna be combined into one regional, and then some of the Northern European countries are gonna be another regional. Now, what that looks like also, some of the spot distribution is gonna be a little different. South America deserves a regional. South America does not deserve five spots to the games. So they are going to get one spot to the games for their regional. So it's going to be very competitive for their athletes to get to the games. And I say, the reason I say they do not deserve a spot is based off of past performance and number of competitors that are able to compete at this top level. That there, even though they have a lot of participants, isn't at the level of these guys yet. But we're still giving them a spot, and they deserve the spot, again, based off of how we're structuring it. The European region in the north will get five spots, the one in the south will get four spots. The United States regionals will all still get five spots. US used to get, or the North America regionals used to get a total of 30 spots, and everywhere else in the world got 10. Now it's looking like the distribution is 25 for North America, and everywhere else in the world gets 15. So we're making it even more of an international sport and more international representation at the games. That's how it's going to be. That's how it's going to be next year, and for the next year, you know, few years going forward, we'll constantly assess, see where the community is taking it, see where, you know, again, with the based off open participation numbers, if some areas just registering an incredible amount of people, like Asia can get there soon, maybe they'd be next to get pulled away from this regional. But it's something we're going to assess on a yearly basis. It's not necessarily something we're going to change on a yearly basis, but we're going to constantly be looking at the data and looking at this. I think that's just going to create an incredible and exciting season for next year that will start with a very exciting open season. 18.1, 18.2, 18.3, 18.4, and 18.5 are all going to be very special.
All right, give it up for Dave Castro. Some exciting news. Hey, thank you guys for sticking around. Thank you for joining us from home. That is the end of the show for us here. We got to go celebrate, but maybe you guys, we power dipped a little bit. Maybe we could finish off with the Aussie, Aussie, Aussie chant. Would the fittest team lead us in that? Have a great night, guys. Thank you.